Today's episode of This Week in Startups is brought to you by Squarespace, an all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create a professional website and now an online store. For a free trial and 10% off your first purchase on new accounts, go to squarespace.com and use the offer code TWIST. And by Wistia. Take control of your video marketing with powerful tools and analytics built specifically for business. Go to wistia.com/twist to get your free Wistia account today. And by AWS Activate, the Amazon Web Services Startup Program. It's easy to start and scale your business with AWS. Visit aws.amazon.com/activate.
Hey everybody, on today's episode of This Week in Startups, I talk with Austen Heinz, who is a mad scientist behind Cambrian Genomics. And what they're doing is they're basically not just reading DNA and reading the human genome and all this. They're printing DNA, and then they're making startup companies out of what they're able to print after they manipulate different genes. It's pretty crazy science fiction level stuff. You're going to get a little Blade Runner in here. You're going to get a little Prometheus. And it really is a little bit, to be totally frank, outside of my pay grade. So you're going to see me in an interview being very confused and learning a lot. And that's what I love to do with this show, This Week in Startups. It's going to be an amazing episode. Cambrian Genomics, amazing. Stick with us.
It's what it's all about, man. They said money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you. Yeah. Money is the root of all evil. What? Funny how it feeds my people. Yeah. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you.
Hey, everybody, welcome to This Week in Startups. This is going to be an amazing episode. It's kind of a first for us. Now that I am living in San Francisco, we're going to try to do more on-location kind of shoots. And as you can see, we're on location today, and we're here at Cambrian Genomics. I pronounced it correct?
That's correct, yeah.
Cambrian.
Cambrian Genomics. Cambrian Explosion.
And Austen Heinz is with me. You're the founder. Now, what does Cambrian Genomics do? And who are you?
Yeah. So, very simple. We make DNA on plates. People will order a design of DNA online and press print, and it'll come to them in the mail just like ordering from Netflix and a plate inside of a package.
Got it. So, the next time I need DNA for my home,
you know where to go.
I know where to go.
Exactly.
Okay. So, now we have to, of course, fill in what is, you know, Blade Runner-esque 2050 kind of stuff with maybe today. So we all heard about the Human Genome Project, like, I guess that was close to a decade ago.
Yeah, almost a decade.
And that was Craig Venter.
Yeah.
George Church was involved in that.
Yes.
Right? I think he's your mentor.
Yes, he is.
Now, that program, explain what that program did and why we all heard about it.
So the Human Genome Project was the idea that we as humans, we have 6 billion letters, A, T, Cs, and Gs.
A, T, Cs, and Gs.
Those are the four molecules that encode everything about us and everything that's alive on the planet.
So there's 6 billion of those.
There's 6 billion of them. The problem.
So these switches could be any one of those four states, which means we're all highly unique.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So 4 × 4 × 4 × 4.
We can just
keep
going.
You can get some complexity there.
This is
right?
Probably the most complex game of poker I've ever played. Like, if you think Pot Limit Omaha's complex, there's a whole different level of complexity.
Yes. Right. So the idea was if we could read the full code, that we could have understandings about our health, who we are, where we came from.
Right.
And to begin with, it was extremely expensive because they had one machine would read one short little strand of DNA, maybe, you know, a few hundred letters mm-hmm. at a time on one machine.
Right.
Right. And so it cost $1 per letter to sequence. So for
wow.
a single human, $6 billion.
Right. And that's why it was such a huge project with so many different organizations and universities
yeah.
involved.
Yeah, because if you were going to, you know, you would have to read billions of strands. So you would need, you know, millions of machines to try to do this work.
Now, when they did that, they did one human? And they never disclosed who that was, right?
They did.
Who was it?
It was Craig Venter.
Of course. So Craig's
yeah.
DNA he's like number one
yeah.
in terms of having your human
right.
genome sequence.
Right.
Now, since that time, and that cost $6 billion, how many people have had their genome sequenced, and what does it cost today?
So this is only less than 10 years ago.
Right.
I guess a little bit more at this point. But within the last 10 years, it's gone from $6 billion per human
for the first
to $1,000, which it is right now. And that announcement was made actually just less than a mile down the street at JP Morgan.
Oh, wow.
Back in February.
Now, is this what 23andMe does, or like when you get your genome sequenced by them? Is that your whole genome?
No,
or?
No, it's not. So they are only looking at the small pieces of DNA called genes, mm-hmm. The coding regions, right. and doing a small subset.
Got it.
Right.
But if you needed to get your entire DNA completely sequenced, mm-hmm. $1,000.
$1,000. And the other thing is that 23andMe, the technology is actually not very good.
Oh, yeah.
They're not actually using sequencers like we have here. They're doing it through an older process, which doesn't read them letter by letter, but reads them instead by binding large pieces of DNA through hybridization. It's not as accurate as modern sequencing technologies that we use here.
You're pointing to a machine behind us here, right. for those people who are listening, not watching, and you really want to watch this episode. But that machine looks like a 3D printer of some sort, or just, some kind of science fiction-like machine. What exactly is it doing when you sequence something? Am I putting my saliva in there or my blood? What exactly happens in a $100,000 custom sequencer like this?
Sure. So
I see formaldehyde, which makes me feel like we're in like Dr. Frankenstein's lab.
It's
here.
Formamide, actually.
Oh, but, formamide. Sorry.
Yeah. So it's probably better to explain it in terms of the context of what we're doing here. Hmm. But in general, a sequencer is something that's simply looking at the letters mm-hmm. of DNA.
Right.
If you're going to sequence a human, you're going to break down its 6 billion letters into small, shorter pieces, maybe 100 letters long each. Put those on billions of beads, and then read each one of them separately, massively parallel,
right,
to reduce the cost. Just like making transistors massively parallel made transistors go from $1 each to now $10 billion in my pocket for, almost nothing.
Right.
This is the same process, the same massively parallel process. It's also what we use to make DNA.
Okay. So that's the big jump, right? Mm-hmm. They're sequencing.
Right.
And now what you're doing is called...
Synthesis. Or writing of DNA.
Okay. So I barely got through biology class. Okay. When you say that you're synthesizing, that means making.
Right.
What exactly are you making when you make or print DNA?
Sure.
Or the genes?
So typically, people aren't interested in doing a copy of something that they maybe already have on hand.
Right.
Usually they're interested in engineering something with new functionality and new capabilities.
Okay.
And when people write books, they typically don't just copy from another book. They want to write something new, interesting for the world. So what people do is they have an idea of a creature that they want to make, whether it's a human being, whether it's an animal, whether it's a yeast, whether it's a bacteria that has some sort of novel properties, right? They design it on a computer using a software called Genome Compiler. It's one of our partner companies. And they then can press print. When they press print, the source code, the ATCs and Gs, go over to this computer. It's attached to the internet. And it basically takes all these sequences, stacks them up, and then starts to divide them into small chunks, small little pieces.
Hmm.
So if it's 6 billion letters, it's 100 letter chunks. If it's 1 million letters, it's 100 letter chunks.
Right.
Right. We make those in 100-letter chunks in this first machine.
Huh.
But the problem is that it's really like when you make anything, whether you're making semiconductors or whether you're sequencing DNA, you don't get a perfection in every one.
Hmm.
So of the DNA that we make, only around 30% is made correctly.
Okay.
So
why is that? Is it that the technology is so new in terms of printing it, or is just organic material
it's
not
just,
stable?
No, it's just physics. I mean, whether you're making underwear, fruit, transistors.
Yeah.
Like, you go into any factory.
There's some waste.
It's the same process in every factory. You walk in, they got a machine that makes a bunch of something.
Yeah.
And then throw it on a conveyor belt. They look at it. Is this good? If it's good, pluck it off, sell it. If it's bad, burn it up. Same process here.
Got it. So, when we would print the magazines, the first X number of copies going through would have bad color or be blurry.
Yeah.
They tweak it and then it'd be fine.
Exactly.
Okay. So you said before that people don't want to just copy stuff, right? So you're not doing photocopies here.
Right.
People want to change stuff. So when you say changing stuff, what would be an application of changing, you know, DNA or a sequence here, and for what end result?
Sure. So, well, we got a good example here. Right. So we're doing between two weeds today. These are tobacco plants.
Yes, between two ferns, yeah. Except these are genetically modified ferns.
They are genetically modified. So what we've done here is we've made the cost of writing, the making of DNA, as cheap as the reading of it.
Okay.
You know, reading is a passive thing, right? You mm-hmm. can just know what the letters are. But if you really want to have an impact, you got to create, you got to make something, right?
Right?
So these things were made. They were designed on computers. They were printed out. And then we took that printed out material, put them inside of a living plant to change its code, basically like putting in a floppy disk or a thumb drive.
Okay.
And put that information inside the cell so that it could grow into this plant. And even its offspring can produce that as well. So this plant in particular has a 5-gene pathway from fireflies.
Okay, so you took a bug, a firefly, one of my daughter's top two or three favorite insects, and you put it into a tobacco plant.
Yeah.
So there's your tobacco here. Now, what happens to the tobacco?
Right. So they are firefly genes, but we drug and dropped small pieces of DNA that would let these genes be expressed or work inside of plants because
okay.
the machinery is a little bit different.
Got it.
So
this glows?
Yes. So this has the luciferin pathway inside of it. So luciferase is a two nanomachine construct. It comes together like this, like a Pac-Man.
Okay.
Right? Luciferin is a small molecule that gets clipped by the Pac-Man, and depending on the angle at which it gets clipped by the Pac-Man, determines the wavelength of the light produced.
Wow. So can I ask a really basic question? How do you take this sequence and put it into a plant? Is it the seed?
No.
Is
okay.
it?
Yeah.
I don't know. Like you said, you put it in like a floppy drive. I'm sure people who are listening.
It's actually a gun. We put it inside a ballistic, and we fire it into the plant.
Okay. Well, what does that gun look like? And what do you mean
it's,
into the plant? It goes into the the stem, the seed. What?
It goes into the part that will make the seeds.
Got it.
Right.
So pre-seed, there's something.
Right.
And you stick it into that cell.
Right.
Under a microscope or something?
Not under a microscope. We just prepare the tissue and we put it into the machine. The machine has DNA on a bullet.
Uh-huh.
The bullet fires inside of those cells, gets inside, because the plants have these cell walls, which makes them more difficult to penetrate.
So you break the cell wall.
Gets inside and then can be incorporated inside of either the nucleus or can be outside of the nucleus.
And that is the spark of, not life, but of some creation.
Yes, because it's just reading it just like a computer would read ones and zeros.
So our cells are designed when that sequence comes in to read it.
Exactly.
So we just blindly read this, and we're not blindly,
whatever
read
there,
what comes in.
Whatever that's there, our hardware or machinery is going to read and process it.
All right, so when we get back, I want to know if we can make glowing humans, number one. And number two, who the hell figured out that this piece of the gene was glowing? Like, how do you know that this is the gene for glowing versus, you know, flying or laser eyes like Cyclops or whatever mutant powers, telekinesis that we're going to be implanting in everybody on This Week in Startups after this important message? Hey, everybody. I want to take a moment just to tell you about Squarespace. Squarespace is the easiest way to create a beautiful, exceptional looking website. I know this because we use it day in and day out for all of the launch festival, launch scale, all the events I do. And actually, now that I have the launch fund, a proper angel investing fund, I realized the other day that we don't actually have a website for that. And I was like, oh, let's just find a beautiful Squarespace template and put one up, and I can do it myself. So I was literally looking through the gorgeous templates, and all the templates are responsive, so they work on mobile. So your iPad, your iPhone, your Android phone, it just works. And they have 24-hour support. It's easy to use. It's super plug and play, and they constantly add new features. Go to squarespace.com and try it for free. No credit card is required, and it starts at only $8 a month, which is absurdly, absurdly cheap. But the service is absolutely first class. So don't let that price scare you. It is literally worth $80 a month or even like $1,000 a year I would pay, because it's just perfect, flawless hosting. It never goes down. It's always up and running. And it's just I can have non-technical people go and upgrade the website, and they constantly add new features, which is one of the great things that software as a service, which is what Squarespace does, is it just provides you this service of beautiful looking websites. You can keep changing stuff and they keep adding features. So if some new feature comes out, like, hey, Twitter's out, we need to put a Twitter button or syndicate our Twitter feed, they're going to have all those widgets and plugins and everything just built into the platform. If you choose to keep your Squarespace.com trial, use the promo code TWIST and you'll save even more. Squarespace is everything you need to create an exceptional website. And anybody in your family, anybody in your circle, so if you need to pop up a website really quick and you want it to look gorgeous for a restaurant, for a small business, for a big business, for an angel investing fund that's incredibly high profile, just go to Squarespace.com. Use the promo code TWIST. Thanks again to our friends at Squarespace. And go ahead and thank them. Thank you at Squarespace on Twitter. Okay, let's get back to this amazing program. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to This Week in Startups. We're here on location at Cambrian Genomics. I'm here with Austen Heinz, having my mind literally melted. And when we left for break, we were talking about your glowing plant here, where you took out a couple of genes?
Yeah.
Or would they be genes from a plant, I guess? Or
well, we didn't take anything out. We read...
Oh, you read.
We read the sequences from the internet. Everything's been read now. Everything that's cute, furry, delicious, anything has been read.
Okay. So you just have people in college who are working in labs just reading anything they get their hands on.
Just reading anything they can get their hands on that they can fund.
So they've been reading it.
Yeah.
And then they printed that and you printed
it. We printed that. Yeah.
And shot it into the cells here.
And
with a gun, essentially.
Yeah, with a gun. Yeah.
Okay. How do we figure out, or does one figure out, that this sequence is for glowing fireflies versus just the firefly's wings or nothing or the color of their feet?
Yeah, so that's cool. So what you can do is you can look at in nature the different species that glow and what's common about these species.
The delta.
Right.
So you take a fly.
Or the not delta.
Or the not delta, right. You take the fly and you take a firefly and you compare them?
So there's bacteria that glow. There's some fungus in Brazil that glow.
Oh, I see what you're saying. So it's not different between a fly and a firefly. Just all the glowing things in the world.
Yeah. And what do they all have in common? Right.
And it actually is something in common.
Yeah. They all share this luciferase pathway. The sequences are slightly different but similar enough that you can match them. It's called blasting. Yeah.
Blasting,
you can take a sequence and find out if you isolate a sequence that you think is interesting, you can look at everything else that has it. You can also take multiple creatures and compare, you know, look for unique, commonly shared sequences.
So how long has, you know, this process of adding things to the global database of organic material living things been going on now George Church and on?
Yeah, you're basically like... Nothing. I mean, this is the same thing with the Human Genome Project.
Right.
It was like 1%, like 5 or 6 or 7 years into the process. And then like,
boom,
it was 1%. And then the next year was 100%. Right. It's growing exponentially, but that's probably an understatement. People use exponentially to say it's growing quickly.
Right.
But I would say, you know, it's probably growing 100 or 1,000-fold every few months terms of what's in there. Yeah.
So, is this all on one computer somewhere, some supercomputer? You say it's on the internet.
Yeah.
So I can go to a website with all this information on it? What is that website?
You can. It's an NCBI database. Yeah.
And it's open to the public? Anybody can grab this stuff? We're working as a global community to put this stuff
out
there.
Exactly. Ebola, you know, whatever you want. Genes from the firefly, whatever.
Is somebody doing like some crazy comparison of everything and everything to everything? Or are people just going in there and just saying like, hey, let's compare gophers to, you know, humans and see what happens?
Okay, so here's what biological research is like when you can only read, okay?
Right.
It's kind of like understanding how a car works when you can only like look at a car and you don't have tools to take apart and rebuild it.
Ah.
It's like, let's take a sledgehammer and like smash up that spark plug thing and see if it still goes.
Right.
If it still goes, probably not that important. If it breaks and the car doesn't go anywhere, that was probably important.
Got it.
That's how people have studied biology when all they can do is read.
Right. They're like, they bang the cup holder, it breaks, and the car still functions, so we're good.
Yeah.
Got it.
But when you can actually write and build it from scratch, from nothing,
right.
you can actually understand it. So I think Richard Feynman said something, you know, the only way I can understand something is if I can make it myself.
Got it. So now that people are printing stuff out and you're enabling this printing at a low cost, what have people been doing? Like, aside from this tobacco plant that you guys made, what have people been doing?
What have they not been doing? Well, I guess we'll watch some commercials for some of these companies. Yeah. You know, these companies have real products, real working things that were developed for very little money. And so they're getting – these companies that are developing new products these days in partnership with Cambrian are getting access to DNA almost at cost or free, below cost. And they are getting access to shared use labs. So we have about 5,000 square feet and two labs on the fourth floor.
Here in San Francisco.
Yeah, above Founders Den.
Right below.
I feel like 90% of the audience may be from San Francisco.
It's a large portion.
We're at 3rd and Townsend if you want to come by.
Yeah.
And then we also have the second floor, about 5,000 square feet down there.
So you have the ability to print this for all your partners. You're holding a vial of something here.
Something.
It's making everybody very nervous and uncomfortable. Now, when you pour that on the ground, like, what's going to happen? The Kraken's going to come out or something? What is
Something's going to come out.
Something's coming out.
Yeah.
So what are we looking at there? Is that like the best acid that anybody's ever printed?
We're looking at some bacteria that are native to our gut microbiome.
Okay, sure.
So we actually have more of these creatures inside of us than we have human cells.
Right. This is like why everybody's doing the what are they? You know, like people are buying Activio, whatever.
Yeah,
good bacteria.
Probiotics.
Probiotics, right.
Yeah. So this is personalized probiotics.
Whoa.
Designed by you on a visual interface. You drag your stuff around. You get what you want personalized to you in the bacteria that you want it in.
So you printed out bacteria for yourself. So if this was for me, we'd be printing out bacteria that would be able to get rid of whatever. If I had celiac disease, rid of like
exactly.
wheat or intolerance or something.
There's 1,000 disorders just related to a microbiome. 14,000 people die every year in the United States just from C. difficile infection, which is caused by taking broad spectrum antibiotic, like lactose intolerance, people that can't eat gluten. You mentioned celiac. There's a number of horrible diseases where you basically just have to get your intestines cut out and poop into a bag that you're carrying.
So you think, or you know, that you'll be able to print out this new bacteria. People doing this? Is this a company now to print out gut bacteria?
Yes, this company is called Personalized Probiotics. The first product I'm holding here is called Petomix because we consider these your pets. So this is a fun product. I don't know about you, but I think poop smells not so great.
Right. Most of us would. That's why we have the colloquialism, that person thinks their blank does not smell.
Shit smells like roses, right?
Right.
Exactly.
Right. So literally, are you telling me that with these probiotics, we're not going to need to spray rose petal spray?
Exactly. That's exactly what I'm telling you right now.
Literally, you're going to kill the air freshener business.
Well, we'll create a new human-powered air freshener business. Yeah.
Wow. So we're going to fart roses.
Yeah. And when you think you're on an airplane, you know, luckily now you're in San Francisco, you don't have to travel as much, but you're bringing 90% farts, right?
Yeah.
So it would be good if they were good smelling, right?
So literally this company, you can take out whatever is causing odor
gut? We sequence the full genome of the microbes, whether it's E. coli or lactobacillus or you know, the hundreds of other bacteria that colonize our gut. We can see sequences that result in smell. It's not always possible to remove them because they're critical to the functioning of it, but you can also put in things that will break down that bad smell produced by those genes. You can also put in inside any smell that you want. All smells that we smell on planet Earth are genetically encoded in the DNA.
Holy
cow. So bananas, roses, lavender, anything.
This is why some people can smell.
You smell these right now.
Or asparagus.
Yeah.
Is it asparagus that some people can smell in their pee and some people can't smell?
Right.
Right. There's like some gene that you either have or not.
Right. It's all genetically encoded. So
fascinating.
The first two products, one is called Banana Breeze and the other is called Minty Winds.
Minty Winds.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
So brilliant.
Yeah.
We can all guess what that means.
Yeah. So you can see smell what's coming out of that. It smells kind of like the artificial banana.
Yeah, it does.
Because that's exactly what it is. And it's funny that artificial banana smell is produced in this microorganism for production. Already, we're just taking it and putting it inside of the gut of living organisms.
Drink that.
Yeah, could drink it right now.
I'm not drinking it, but I might drink it. Actually, we do shots of banana So this is going to make people's poop smell like bananas.
In this case. If they want roses, they could do that. If they want mint. We also recently just did a vaginal probiotic company called Sweet Peach, which allows you change the smell and the taste. Also be useful for things like urinary tract infections, yeast infections.
I've got like a million jokes right now. I'm not going to go there, but basically...
When we watch the commercials, maybe...
You're saying that...
Tell some jokes.
The taste... You could change the taste of a vagina.
Yeah, exactly.
And you're coming up with these ideas, or people are pitching you on these ideas...
So these initial ideas were all ideas that I would come up with friends sitting around like, hey, wouldn't that be kind of messed up or cool, like if we did this, or hey, what if we did that?
Right.
And it was usually a joke. And then we were like, well, let's see how far we can go with it.
Right.
When we launched this on Kickstarter, you know, it did 500,000 in 6 weeks. We had
you're referring to the glow in the dark tobacco.
Yeah, we've sold almost $1 million worth of these plants so far.
So this is not hypothetical anymore.
No.
You're actually selling this. You've made a product through...
Yeah. So we have great entrepreneurs come in and say, look, I can do that. You know, Anthony Evans, he's the man behind the creation of this, was really nothing. It was just an idea. You know, plants hadn't glowed for 3 billion years. Plants have been around a long time, never glowed. You know, Anthony and his team, they fixed that problem.
Let me ask you a question. We'll go to our break in a second, but... When we come back from break, I want to know if you could make a dog or a human glow. And if so, is there any legal ramification for doing this in humans or dogs when we get back from this important break? Hey, everybody. I want to tell you about Wistia. Wistia is a private B2B, like business-to-business solution for serving up HD videos. It's software as a service. It's sort of like, you know, how MailChimp does email or other services. You know, Squarespace provides hosting and websites, beautiful, elegant ones. This is for video. Wistia is gorgeous and perfect and easy to use. And the way Wistia wound up becoming a partner on the program is I was looking for some way to control 100% of the experience for when you come to thisweekinstartups.com of what you experience on the player. Like, I don't want, like on other services where they start sending you to other videos and try to increase their engagement on their site, and then it's got all their logos all over it. I just wanted to have a clean, beautiful player. And I was like, oh my God, I'm going to have to pay somebody to put a video server up or get in, you know, a cloud account or FTP storage. I was like, this is too much work. All I want is a place to upload my files and have them be super clean and elegant. And then I found out, so when I tweeted, I'm looking for this, literally out of 50 responses, 45 were Wistia. And then I found out about all the other features Wistia has. Like, you can, when the video is playing, say, hey, would you like to get more emails from Jason? Put your email address in. If you're using another service, they won't let you do that because they don't trust you to actually engage your own audience, right? And that's just, to me, horrific. That's why I was really pissed off at those other companies that are all about them and all about sending traffic around their network. And when people subscribe, they get to keep their email addresses and we don't get it. Now we get to have that little opt-in. Hey, would you like to get, you know, more from This Week in Startups or the Launch Festival or Insight or whatever it is? Additionally, I can make the size the way I want it. And then it has analytics so I can see who's watching the program. And it's very detailed, granular analytics that you just can't get from other services because they don't want you having the data. They're trying to intermediate your relationship with your audience. Well, I'm trying to disintermediate those people, and I want to have a direct relationship with my audience. That's why I use Wistia. This is what professionals like MailChimp, Moz, Blank Label, This Week in Startups, and many others use. They have 50,000 customers. The company's doing amazing. They have a ton of support as well. So if you are in the business of video, and listen, every business is going to need video, you don't want to put your videos out there in all these other random places. You want to have a beautiful, crisp, clean player on your site with a URL that says, hey, here's our explainer video. Here's how our product works. Here's an interview with our clients, or here's my podcast, whatever it is. And that's what Wistia provides. It was like my dream come true. I love using the product, and it like works really beautiful with like Twitter. So when you put it in there, it embeds it automatically, like tweet cards and all that stuff. So everybody thank at Wistia, W-I-S-T-I-A. And thanks so much for giving us a professional solution. Hey, go to wistia.com/twist, and no credit card is required. And the three videos that you put up, the first three are free. Thanks again, wistia.com/twist. Let's get back to this amazing episode. All right, everybody, welcome back to This Week in Startups. You can follow the show on Twitter at TWI Startups. You can go to thisweekinstartups.com and all that great stuff. So we're here in San Francisco. As many of you know, I've moved up here now. After 30 years in New York and 10 in LA, I finally took the jump. And we're going to be doing more stuff here in person. So we're just going to different places. And high on producer Jackie's list was Cambrian Genomics.
And very good.
We're sitting here with Austen Heinz, having our minds blown about our farts smelling like mint, vaginas tasting like peaches, and tobacco plants glowing in the dark. Basically, we're getting into...
We're not even halfway through yet.
And we're not even halfway through. So we're going to just keep going here. What is the... The government doesn't care if you...
The U.S. government.
Yeah, okay. Let's talk about the U.S. government okay. here, because I know in North Korea and other places, like, and I'm sure Cuba and Venezuela, you can do whatever the hell you want. They probably are. But what are there any rules around doing this kind of reprinting and shooting sequences into plants in the United States? Anybody can do whatever they want?
We talked to the regulatory authorities at the USDA as well as the EPA, both green-lighted this for sale in the United States.
Okay, so they did talk to them about
yeah.
it. Are they on top of this? Because now you can use the software to change stuff. You can print stuff. Would they even know that people are doing this? They wouldn't even know. So are there laws about this?
Well, here's the thing. There's only a couple places in the world that can print DNA.
Ah, okay. So there is a gating factor.
Yeah, so we have a consortium called the International Synthetic Gene Consortium. I think it's like the IGSC. But we look at all the sequences coming in, talk about things that may be problematic. And if it's something that's problematic, we're not going to print it. It's very bad for business if you were to make something that
So you're regulating yourself
yeah.
in a
yeah.
major way.
In a major way, because if we didn't do that and the government were to regulate,
yeah.
you'd have serious problems.
So you think about these things, you kind of give them a heads up,
yeah.
and they give you a green light.
Exactly.
Now, what about with a human or a dog? Because obviously dog breeding has been going on for a long time. In fact, all modern dogs, mm-hmm. all these purebreds right, are just people yeah. doing crossbreeding. But could we make bulldogs that glow?
Sure. They already have.
They have made glowing
yeah.
dogs,
yeah.
really.
Glowing dogs and glowing cats.
I didn't know those existed.
Well, they're not glowing. They
I
don't
that
like
Indiegogo campaign.
Yeah. Unlike these plants, they right. don't produce their own light. But if you right. have a black light, they
will
see
glow,
it because
right.
they're fluorescent, not luminescent, meaning they will, you know, they will take light and they will emit it at
so
a different
So we don't have the ability as humans to be luminescent yet.
Sure, but I see no reason why not.
So
and I think eventually that would be a good idea to make luminescent humans. I'll tell you why. If you want to know.
I have my own ideas. I mean, I just think Burning Man is going to be yeah. much more awesome if we're all glowing.
Yeah, well, if we can make light in our brains, it gives us a really great interface into our minds.
Well, that'd be great because yeah. you'd be basically sitting in class and the teacher would know who's not even thinking.
You're not even thinking. There's nothing
just,
light. There's nothing light enough
Mr.
there.
Mr. Calacanis.
Yeah.
It'd be like,
exactly.
Yeah. Although if it's going too crazy, they'd be like, hey, listen, this is not that interesting.
Yeah. I mean, you really want to get and just actually see the picture in their mind and just have a monitor above every student's
yeah.
head with exactly what, you know, probably would need to face one way because most of them would be X-rated. But yeah.
There are translucent beings in the world like
sure.
jellyfish.
Yeah.
At some point, could we make our skin and our cells translucent?
I think they're already working on making translucent brains because they're easier to study.
Translucent brains would yeah. be fascinating. But what about the skull and the skin? I mean, is that even possible? I wonder.
Is it possible?
Maybe
Every,
it's possible,
if it doesn't,
but you might burn
if it,
your
yeah.
brain if you went in the sun.
No, I mean, yeah. I mean, if it doesn't violate the laws of physics, it's possible.
Right, right, exactly. Okay, so now what about doing these type of printing on things that are not plants, that things are mammals or reptiles.
Yeah.
Like, where is the state of the industry today here in the United States? And then You must be privy to stuff going on outside the United States. And are there people doing stuff, do you think, through the grapevine or the circles you travel in that we would find similar to like the movie Splice or Blade Runner?
Well, I think Blade Runner is happening right here in San Francisco. And eventually everything that's alive will be synthetic and designed on a computer. I think you'll
Everything that's alive will have been designed on a computer.
Will be made here, designed by someone out there.
So all human beings
all
will
human
have been
beings,
designed. Nobody will have an organic baby.
No, no. And an owl, a natural owl, will go for millions of dollars because there's no natural owls left.
I mean, I did see Blade Runner. So basically, you're Sebastian. These are my friends. I made them. That's my Sebastian from
it's
Blade
so
Runner.
It's so good. It's right on. Right on. Yeah, that's the
you
idea.
You need to talk to Tyrell. He's the boss. He made your brain. I only made your eyes. Tyrell, big boss, made your brain. That's the guy with the eyes. And if you guys know Blade Runner, I got your eyes. Yeah. Rucker Howard's putting the eyes all over him.
Yeah.
So you're saying, okay, so that's a sci-fi thing, but legitimately, you're not printing stuff and putting it into mammals or reptiles yet.
No. So the projects that we're picking right now are consumer products and unregulated products. But as far as unregulated products go, there's a pretty wide swath.
Yeah, that's good.
So probiotics are a completely unregulated market. You know, I think in 94, some supplement companies poisoned a few people. And the FDA tried to come in. But you got to think Herbalife, these are multi-billion dollar companies.
Sure.
This is one instance where horrible, big, evil companies actually can do some good in terms of getting rid of regulation. But they hired Mel Gibson and all these people to go on ads and say, hey, don't let the FDA take away your vitamins.
Right.
So there's a huge – as far as the microbiome is concerned, you've got a really open space. And we've talked to people from the FDA about that and seen that we don't control that. That's a supplement.
Got it. So supplements are a place where you could actually participate.
Right.
And so probiotics is the first one. Are there going to be other supplements that we'll be taking?
So there'll be vaginal supplements. There'll be under your arm supplements so that you can control your body odor. Actually, people think that humans produce smells. Humans don't produce smells.
Right.
We are odorless. It is the creatures that live on us that produce smell.
Ah, interesting.
Yes.
So we'll be able to affect those.
Yeah. So some races like Koreans, for instance, don't smell. You know, this is a totally scientific thing because white people release a molecule that bacteria love to feed on. The smelly bacteria
so
love
Caucasians
to feed on.
Caucasians do this.
Caucasians,
yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Koreans don't. So you
Koreans
go into a Korean locker room, it smells 100% better than going into a bunch of white dudes. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Nuts. Yeah.
Okay. So when will people start? Because you can. Right now you're saying
some other great ones too. So toothpaste with the reason why you get your,
halitosis.
Yeah, or why halitosis and also tooth decay is because sugar breakdown. Uh-huh. The sugar is broken down by your bacteria into acid, which wouldn't be so bad except it eats through your enamel. So you don't have to kill those bacteria. You can simply produce a neutralizing agent.
Right? So you could neutralize the bacteria and not have your teeth. So cavities will go away.
Exactly. But you probably still want to remove the food product, but you know, not worry about cavities. Also, people have you know, dry skin issues. That's because they shower every day. They wipe away the natural bacteria. So you could have you know, probiotics in your shampoo that deal with dandruff and things like that.
So let me ask a question about in the last 10 years, did you think – 10 years ago, because you've been working on this for a while.
Yeah, I think it's almost been 10 years.
Yeah. 10 years ago, did you think we would have been where we are today or further behind or further ahead? Where did you think 10 years ago we would be?
I thought completely different. So when I first raised my first money, it was around when I was 21, 22, so around 2005, 2006, to build my first creature lab. And that was right at the time when Rothberg came out with the 454 machine, which is the first massively parallel sequencer, dropped the price by 100,000 overnight and 1 million shortly after. And it was just like, wow, sequencing, you can see it's right on the roadmap to being solved and costing almost nothing. So, of course, some smart person out there is going to make a way to write this stuff.
Right.
But for some reason, that never caught on. No one ever thought that the writing or the making of life was as important as passively reading it.
Right.
But like I said, with books, you know, you read a million books, the world doesn't change. You write one book, a million read it, big change.
Big change.
Yeah. So it was like, I don't know, it was probably like Larry and Sergey, like back when no one cared about search and thought the portal was everything.
Yeah, of course.
Like no one, it's completely blind spot. Hey, we're all made of DNA. Everything right. that's alive is DNA. And if you can write it,
so you had
it,
no idea
valuable.
We'd be where we are now.
I was not expecting this problem to have, I would have expected it to be solved 5 years ago.
Oh, you did expect printing yeah. would be solved.
5 years ago.
Five years ago. So printing, and so now in 10 years, knowing what you know, which we don't know as intimately, where will we be in 10 years? If you've made it easy enough to print these, what would it cost to print a plate now?
So we're currently selling around 3 to 5 cents a letter.
3 to 5 cents a letter, which means a human with 6 billion, which is out of the question to print
still,
that.
Still pretty expensive.
Right.
But
nobody's printing that anyway, right?
Right. But that's true. But it's definitely there. The reason why we're doing that is to capture margin, to build additional pipeline, mm-hmm. And to not immediately saturate the market, which would happen if we did that. We would have oversaturate. We would provide way more DNA than
So 3 cents to print one of the letters.
But you know, it will fall by an order of magnitude every year, or two orders of magnitude every year, starting in 2015.
It will become 3 cents to print 100 letters
but
at some point.
But so this cost that I'm telling you about, this is the cost paid for by the larger corporations, the giant right. pharmaceuticals, the giant Dow chemical, industrial chemical companies, the Monsantos of the world. But for the people that are entrepreneurs that have a very creative idea, it's free.
Hmm.
So the entrepreneur, it's not completely free. They're paying for it with stock.
Gotcha.
But it's free for them to use. So it gives these two, three people companies the same power as a Monsanto.
So you're going to startups who have ideas and saying, we'll do the printing for you.
Yeah.
Which you would never be able to afford.
Yeah, because you would have to literally caveman style find something in nature, physically cut it out, like with a fork and knife.
Right.
And then paste it. And that process can take months and months to make a single thing. That,
so you'll
that
just say, hey,
well
we'll take a royalty of 10% or 5% on something like this?
Or we'll take a stock position in exchange as an investment in your company.
Interesting. So a couple of points or 10% or something?
Yeah, 10%.
10%.
Yeah,
so if you want to start the company that makes glow-in-the-dark tobacco,
We'll show you how to crowdfund a campaign where you can raise enough money, maybe $500,000 up front, pay for your team for, a year, a year and a half. You have a shared use lab, so you don't have to buy any equipment, and you have all the DNA, so you don't have to pay any money. You just got to pay overhead for people cost.
Right.
You can get to product, and then you could do a Series A, you could do a seed. Mm-hmm. You could do a seed round, Series A, but these aren't like the $10 million, $20 million Series A that we see for biotech companies. This is like a normal, maybe $200K to $1 million.
Where did you come up with this idea of instead of, catering to the big companies, which I'm sure you have some of them as clients?
Well, no. And so the big companies is where the cash comes. I mean, so it's basically an ATM that we can use to increase our capacity, mm-hmm. and also enable people who otherwise wouldn't have been able to print DNA to print DNA.
Got it. So it was just some creative idea like, hey, let's work with entrepreneurs to try to make startups.
Yeah. Just because we can print DNA, so cheaply
right.
that the real cost is almost nothing internally.
Right.
So instead of immediately saturating the market, we'll get some margin off of the larger corporations to expand our operations.
Okay. So 10 years from now, if everything keeps going at this pace, what will you be able to do? What will you be doing?
Really exciting things you probably never thought about.
Okay, give me
some. So, what is this? What is this stuff?
This is you, rubbing your hand, massaging your fingers.
Massaging my fingers, but it's meat. And this meat is protein,
right?
What is in the protein that makes, organizes the bone, the fat, everything.
Yeah.
It's the machine, the nanomachine that makes everything. So, how many components make up a protein? It's only 20. It's 20 amino acids.
Okay.
So let's take a step back. DNA goes to RNA, and that's converted into proteins. And the proteins are all this that I'm touching.
Right.
Right?
Flesh.
And bone. It makes the bone. It makes the fat. Organizes everything. So it's only made of 20 different components. So DNA is four components, mm-hmm. right? A, T, G, C. And then we have 20 amino acids,
right?
When you can rewrite the code of an entire organism, you can expand the amino acid code. So you can change a human from only being, or any animal, from only having 20 amino acids to having, say, hundreds or potentially thousands.
So you could have more components for us to build our bodies.
Everything that's alive right now, you know, it's four letters of, you know, DNA, right. And it's 20 amino acids, right? That's crazy. What, you know, only 20? That's why everything looks pretty similar. But if you want some radically crazy looking, like fire breathing dragon type stuff, or, you know, plants that maybe grow into solar cells that plug into an electrical grid, you need to start producing organisms that can, you know, incorporate metal and complex materials.
So now we're starting to get into super science fiction type stuff. You're saying even if you put minerals or metal into the mix, you might be able to create a snake or something, or the owl, as you were talking about before with the Blade Runner metaphor, you know, that had titanium bones or something,
right.
Or a beak made out of metal or something.
Yeah, or, you know, super gigantic dinosaurs that are, you know, as tall as this building. But that could be done with we were pretty sure that those dinosaurs had the same amino acid subunits that we did.
Right.
But yeah, you get to really exotic things. Things that we would think maybe about aliens looking like. I mean, you open up the palette, you know, you go from 20.
And you think that's only 10 years away from.
Oh, that's not 10 years away. That's happening right now.
People are starting to do that.
People have already done that.
What have they done?
They've incorporated all these metals that I'm talking about.
Yeah.
So DNA, RNA, protein, okay?
Yeah.
So the DNA goes to RNA, which is a four-letter code like DNA. It's just, I don't know why it's there. Maybe it doesn't even need to be there, right? But then it's got to be made into a nanomachine or a protein, a string of an amino acids that has some activity, does something, right? So you can take the little machines, the little things called tRNAs, and switch them out. So these are the things that bind to the ribosome and add to the growing protein strand.
Mm.
So instead of adding one of the existing things, you can rewrite it so it adds something different.
Right.
So it adds a metal, or it adds a fluorophore, it adds an aldehyde, it adds a ketone, it adds some other weird functional group, adds whatever you want. And so you can get extremely bizarre materials.
But you would have to be able to have that not break down into a pile of goo or something.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
So isn't that part of like the stability, just like our bodies reject transplants or other things? Is there some issue around stability? So when you say people are adding metal, are they adding it to like a little bacteria cell that dies a week later?
Bacteria, yeast.
Yeah,
primarily
so, and
now.
It dies a week later or something.
Maybe not necessarily.
Oh, okay. A little bit longer.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you could start to see kelp, you know, that mine platinum out of the ocean. You could see fish going around mining gold and things out of the ocean and then washing up on shore once they've got their fill. And, you know, the miners just pick up the fish off the shore. You get some really kind of crazy.
Where did you get that idea from? Wow, that's crazy. So
that's
they're
crazy,
mining
right?
gold.
Yeah, with fish.
So they just go to the bottom of the ocean.
They swim around. And there's lots of precious metals in the ocean.
Just floating.
Yeah.
They eat it and then
they process it. Like they already take mercury, right?
Yeah.
So just get them to go after other stuff and then come back to a home location. Like many of them do. Salmon already do that, right?
Yeah. So we could basically just fish all the mercury out of the ocean and have that group of tuna.
Yeah.
Or salmon die for the rest to be healthier without mercury.
There's
in them.
All these great challenges that we have can be solved by code, like global warming, for instance. There are plants that have different pathways, like a C3, C4.
Mm.
One of those pathways is much more efficient at taking carbon out of the atmosphere.
Right.
If every plant that we grew took like 10 or 100 times more carbon out of the atmosphere,
just suck it out.
We just change it depending on what we wanted that year. Right.
That's insane.
Right.
And wasn't that one of like. Ventnor's
terraforming,
right?
Yeah.
So now we went from Blade Runner to Splice, and now we're getting to Prometheus.
Prometheus, or what's a better one? Where was Arnold Schwarzenegger goes to Mars? Total Recall.
Total Recall, which is more cloning.
Yeah. Well, Total Recall at the end of the movie.
Got it. Yes.
Where they releasing the out of the volcanoes?
Yeah.
Right? And so there's actually a company downstairs called Universal Biomining, universalbiomining.com, using our synthetic DNA to reprogram microorganisms to produce oxygen from Martian soil. So Martian soil has perchlorate, and the polar caps, there's also water. You mix those together with these bacteria, and you put them into a beaker and a balloon on top, oxygen will fill up. So there's no ionosphere on Mars, so whatever you make is going to get blown off into deep space, but you can have partial terraforming.
You could put up a tarp, put this on the ground and fill the tarp like you did the balloon.
Yeah. Or people something to people that really upset about, oh, why aren't we going to space? And Elon Musk is like, why isn't there? Well, like, I don't want to go to Mars and just like look at some stupid rocks.
Yeah.
Like, there's got to be some reason for me to go there.
Right.
And trying to go there with the technology we have now, where I can't say print fuel on demand or make my food interesting cuisine on demand, or you know, modify myself in such a way that would make me more likely to survive cancer out there. Would I really want to go?
The following interview with Austen Heinz was far too interesting for just one show. Part two will be released next week. We are at TWI Startups, and he is at Jason on the Twitter.